watching The Producer's Room, a streaming web series featuring the creators behind the hit songs of today's music industry. Songwriters, music producers, and artists discuss their creative process as well as examining current issues and technologies in today's rapidly changing music business. Your host is producer, songwriter, and educator Dave Tuff. Welcome to The Producer's Room. Welcome to this episode of The Producer's Room. I'm your host, Dave Tuff. We have an exciting guest today, L. Russell Brown. But before we get to Russell, L. Russell, I want to talk a little bit about the console here. We had some viewers writing in and asking us about more of the history of this console. As I had mentioned on the last show, it was used for Peter Frampton and the live album Frampton Comes Alive. It was used for the band Last Waltz. But I wanted to get into a little bit more of its history in the later 70s. The console was used for the movie The Big Easy with Dennis Quaid. It was used for Bobby Blue Bland, the Moody Blues in their ABC special, Joe Walsh at the Hard Rock Cafe in Dallas, B.B. King, and last but not least, the gentleman who wrote me here says, more projects with Willie Nelson than I care to remember. So anyway, there's Willie Nelson for you. Once again, special guest today, L. Russell Brown. And so many things that you're known for, songwriter, producer, even writing some Broadway musicals nowadays, right? So,
yes,
thanks for being on The Producer.
Thanks for having me here.
So let's go ahead and start from the beginning. I don't want to dwell on a lot of things in the past. I want to talk about what you're doing today as well. But where'd you grow up? Where are you from originally?
I grew up in a place called Seth Boyden Housing Projects in Newark, New Jersey. I was the oldest of seven and five brothers in one room.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You woke up with feet in your face many, many mornings. But it was a great place because when you walked outside, after you got past your first three or four fist fights, you had 25 friends. So it was a wonderful way to grow up. And to this day, we even have reunions every year where you see people you don't recognize from your...
Right.
From your and I put together a band and we used to play on the roof. I played harmonica, and my buddy played the drumsticks on a box, and the other guy played the guitar. And that's my first band.
I mean, what was the scene like? I mean, were you writing music as a young child, and what was the scene like that you grew up with musically? Were you influenced by your family?
In my house, there was always Bing Crosby playing. Al Jolson was playing. Music was always playing. Russ Colombo.
Uh-huh.
I was named after a great singer who died in the 20s called Russ Colombo. That's how I became L. Russell Brown.
Ah, gotcha.
Actually named after this man who was Bing Crosby's competition. But music was always playing in my house. And although I have no formal music education, from the time I can ever remember, I had an education in music. It came out of the record player.
So being a musician and listening to music, did you start writing lyrics, poetry, playing instruments early?
I just had a harmonica until a friend of mine played me a 78 of That's All Right, Mama by Elvis Presley. And the next day I went to Sears and bought a silver-toned electric guitar, and I was Elvising out. As soon as I learned how to play the guitar, instead of singing one of his songs, I wrote my own song. Why I wrote my own song, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so the first thing I ever played on guitar was a song that I wrote myself.
And so did that lead to your first record deal? Because I know you got your first record deal when you were pretty young.
I wrote so many songs that were just exercises in futility. And eventually I went up to Harlem, and Bobby Robinson, who had Fury Records, and his big hit was Kansas City by Wilbur Harrison. Uh-huh. I played in this, in Harlem, was totally black with white preachers on milk boxes back in 1956. And I went into the record shop, but that was the record company. And I sang with my friend like two songs we had written. And he said, I'll sign you and make a record with you. And sure enough, we signed the paper, went down, made a record, and we had Panama Francis. We had King Curtis. You've heard of King Curtis, haven't you?
Yeah, King Curtis.
I wouldn't allow King Curtis to play in there. I said, we're the Everly Brothers. We don't We don't have saxophones. That's just before King Curtis exploded.
Yeah.
I start her off with a major error.
But this was even in the days before the Brill Building. So was there a publishing, or was the Brill Building existing that
whole
camp?
I was evicted from nearly every record company and building in Manhattan. So that's why I ended up in Harlem.
Okay.
And then that record sold two copies. It's called Wait Up Baby by the Duels. You can see it, hear it on YouTube. I went to the military, traveled around. I toured Europe to the military as a performer. Mm-hmm. Came back with the fellow from Georgia who I was in the military with, Raymond Bloodworth, and we knocked around Greenwich Village. And in the pubs next to us were people who recorded on this, Bob Dylan.
Right.
They were right next to us, the Birds. They were in the other places, and we were singing the Everly Brothers songs and the Kingston Trio songs.
Yeah.
And finally, what turned my life around was something very strange. We convinced the man who invented a thing called, you know, the little part of your zipper that holds a flange when you do it? It holds it from going down.
I don't use it often enough.
I know, but we all don't. That flange, the man who invented that flange, his name was Dick Wegerson, I convinced him to put up $2,500 to make a record, in which he did, and that Bob Crew, the great producer, heard that record and got it into a movie called Frankenstein Meets the Space Monster, one of the worst.
It sounds like a late 50s, early
of all
60s
time. Type movie. And then he signed me.
Ah.
But it all had started with the stay down zipper.
Thank God you would have never been here if we hadn't had the stay down zipper.
Right.
So then did all of that lead to meeting up with the Four Seasons, or am I jumping ahead?
No, you're not jumping ahead. That led to Bob Crew having me produce and write for many acts, including my own, put us on the Dick Clark tour.
Wow.
As artists with the Yardbirds and Jeff Beck, and who became my friend. But I've never spoken to those guys since that time. They knew me as Larry Brown. They don't know about any of the hits I had after that. I had hits the following year.
So now they're going to see you and reach out for me.
I would love to see those guys from the Yardbirds. They all became superstars.
Yeah.
But Bob Krug had a group called Mitch Ryder and the Detroit Wheels.
Yeah, I'm familiar.
And he asked me to rehearse them, which I did, and then he wrote a song with me for them, and one song for that album. And when I felt they were ready, Crew took them in the studio and produced them. Mm-hmm. I worked with them for 3 months every day, and I had the second single, and it was a million sellers, Suck It to Me, Baby.
Wow.
2 months later, I wrote a song on a Wednesday, and Frankie Valli and Bob Gaudio heard it on Friday, and they recorded it on the weekend. And by Tuesday, it was playing on every radio station in Manhattan.
And what was that song?
Come On, Marianne, and it's in the Jersey Boys.
Wow. So it still has a life of its own.
Incredible.
In that music.
That's before I did anything with Tony Orlando.
So were you known as a songwriter in those circles, or more of a musician, and you made that transition, or people knew you wrote songs?
I never wanted – it was never a thought to be a songwriter.
Yeah.
I only wrote songs so that I could sing them and become a singer.
Sure.
I wanted to be the star.
Yeah.
But after I finished with Knock Three Times – after I finished with Come On, Marianne, I hooked up with Irwin Levine, and we wrote Knock Three Times. And after I wrote Tie a Yellow Ribbon, I walked out of my house one day, and I had seven hits, and I said, Brown, you're a songwriter. How it happened, I don't know.
Yeah. And then that ties into my next question, which was, how did you and Irwin hook up? And was it through the Four Seasons?
When I came out of the military,
a
friend of mine, best friend, was going out with Irwin Levine's sister. He brought me to his house.
Uh-huh.
Irwin Levine had his first record on the charts. This is a long time ago. He said, I'm already working with Al Cooper.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm writing with Al Cooper, and we wrote This Diamond Ring.
Ah.
And I don't want to write with a new writer, you know, but I think you're talented. And Irwin and I didn't get together until 5-6 years, till after I wrote Come On, Marianne. We used to take the bus together into New York City. We never wrote together. We took the bus together and we talked. And then one night, the producer for Tony Orlando said, Tony has a huge hit with Come On, Marianne. I mean, with Candida.
Candida.
And I don't have a follow-up. And Tony Wine, his writing partner, ran off and married Chips Moman and went to Memphis. Would you guys go write me a song?
Yeah, yeah.
So we never wrote together. We're just buddies. He says, go give it a try. We went to Irwin's house that night, and we wrote a song called Knock Three Times.
Mm-hmm.
And when we finished this song, Irwin said to me, Larry, I have to use the men's room. I said, go ahead.
Yeah.
So he went into the men's room, and while he was there, I figured out an idea. I said, why don't we sing the chorus the first time, and the next time, instead of singing it, we go, oh, my dog, we'll hit it.
Right.
As a signal kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I love this idea, and I said, I called him Veen. Veen, come on out. He said, I'm coming right out. Hurry up. But 10 minutes, 15, 20 minutes, what was he doing in there? And I was so excited to show him. So finally he walks out of the loo,
yeah,
looks very relieved, and he sits down. What's the idea, Brown? I showed it to him. He freaked. He said, that's sensational. We'll show it to Hank tomorrow. And that's how it became.
You know what? I think that actually, we usually do this later on the show, but that ties into, let's go and play it. And if you want to tell us a little bit more about the song. And who did you say it was produced by?
Produced by Hank Metters, who produced, like, you know, He's So Fine.
Okay.
The Chiffons.
Yeah. All right. So it already has that kind of Spanish feel to it. How did you guys come up with that?
Well, we both love the Drifters.
Yeah.
And it was kind of like some of the Drifters songs had this kind of feel to it too.
Yeah.
Before we did. And Candida had that kind of feel. So I wanted something that was like the cousin of Candida.
Sure, sure.
So I sat down at the piano and played the only three chords that I knew. And wrote this melody while Irwin wrote the lyric. And I assisted him. He talked about my life in the housing projects and how there was only one phone in the building. So if you lived on the first floor, you got one hit on the radiator pipes that went through the building.
Yeah.
And that's how that song came to be. From the living in the project with one phone in nine apartments.
So I was listening musically, there's the two hooks, actually. There's the tapping on the pipe, but then there's also the stomp, clap, when the hook's supposed to be. How would you describe, I mean, is that something you came up with in the session as well?
You know, in reality, there is nothing really new.
Yeah.
When I was 10 years old, there was a song by a group called, I think, the Irish Rovers, and it was called the Boom Boom Boom.
Uh-huh.
It was a drinking song, an Irish drinking song, and it went like this here. You'll never get rid of the boom, boom, boom. And then the next time he went, you'll never get rid of the...
Ah.
So I said, hey,
right.
Boom, 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 you know, and I kind of took the boom, boom, boom's concept.
Yes.
It's a different melody, different lyric.
Sure, sure, sure. But you put it in people's head and they sing it then when they're not expecting it.
And we made it a signal. As opposed to them saying this was a thing they found in a box, the boom, 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 the mysterious thing.
So when you guys demoed it back then, was it where you just went to the executive's office and played it live, or did you actually record it on tape?
We called up Hank Metters the next morning, went to his office, and sang it for him live. There was never a demo on it.
Oh, my God.
All we did is we took the tape recorder, pushed the button, and gave him a set of us singing and playing it.
Yeah.
Irwin didn't play, me playing it, and
right,
singing it.
Right.
And then the following day, he had Tony come in, and Dave Apple, who was the arranger,
mm-hmm,
and co-producer, and I sang it for them.
And what Tony think of the song? Is it totally sold at the beginning, or...?
Tony's attitude about the song was similar to mine. You know, that is ridiculous. It was ridiculous. I thought it was ridiculous. And Irwin and the producer knew it was a monster hit.
Right.
We sold 100,000 records a day for 10 straight days in New York.
Wow.
But I thought it was too much like, I was into the Doors and Light My Fire and the Beatles. And here's this song like Yummy, Yummy, Yummy. That's what I thought about
it.
But going on to after we had a couple of hits with Tony, then we had a 2-year period with no hits with Tony. And then one day we brought him a song that no one else wanted. We brought it to the producer, and he loved this song. And he asked me to play it for Tony the next day. And I played it for Tony. Our knees were touching, and he said, I could never sing that, Brown. That's a country song. I said, it's not a country song. I said, it's kind of like an amalgamation of pop, country, folk music.
Mm-hmm.
It's something all unto itself. He said, well, I just don't know if I could sing it. He said, I like the way you do it, Brown. You should sing Tie a Yellow Ribbon. But the producer, thank God, convinced him to do it, and he did it, and now he does it every night. Thank God.
Hold that thought. We're going to go to a quick break, and we'll be right back.
Ryan, how does it feel to be the Predator's seventh man?
It's an amazing feeling.
What do you think the coaching staff saw in you?
Well, I had this jersey.
Could you tell us a bit about your background?
Well, I've been playing hockey almost daily since 97 on a bunch of different gaming platforms.
Have you given much thought to your training regimen?
I think I'll start training.
Be the seventh man. Learn how you can get an official Predators jersey in Nashville Predators Banking at Fifth Third Bank, the official currency of Smashville.
Hey guys, welcome to this week's episode of Dave's Waves. Hope you enjoy it.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Dave's Waves. Got some requests to do some Coldplay and talk about Coldplay's production. As always, on the Dave's Waves segment, we discuss some mix technique or production technique, arrangement technique, songwriting technique. Today we're going to focus on, or the one I picked was Viva La Vida. And Viva La Vida, Live the Life by Coldplay, won the Song of the Year in 2009, produced by Brian Eno and the band. If I had to point out anything before we get started, obviously this song is based around a string ostinato, so a string loop, if you will. So taking that from hip hop, the band, or dance music, EDM music, the band was inspired that way. At least, in fact, I hear a lot of EDM influence in this, even though it's an orchestrally based song. When I say orchestrally based, you'll see what I mean here in a minute. It has timpani, has church bells in it, a lot of strings, obviously. String arrangements, David Rossi, I'm not sure how you say his last name, R-O-S-S-I, and I think he played through the rest, or he arranged the rest of the album as well as played on it on Viva La Vida. Like I said, once again, produced by Brian Eno, and of course, mixed by Michael Brauer. And we'll talk about all that, but let's go ahead and get started listening. Let's stop there. So far, a lot of cool stuff we can talk about. So the first thing, let's go ahead and start with the string stem. Obviously, it's real strings, so this is mislabeled here. It says keys. It's probably some synthesizers mixed in, but most of these tracks I'm playing you today are stems from the original session. But you'll notice first with the ostinato pattern that I was talking about, the string part gets four downbeats, din, 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 and then four upbeats, which to me is the crucial hook in this song. So we talk about defying expectations with the listeners hearing four downbeats, and then all of a sudden you switch it up to four upbeats. That's already defying expectations in the first two measures of the song. So let's go ahead and listen to that. We go to a drier string. So you'll notice there was a synthesizer first off mixed with these strings here at the beginning. So synthesizer, and then we go, Michael Brauer probably looked at it and goes, okay, it's the verse. We got to make it more intimate and dry. So he dried out the strings and just made it the strings there. This is a nice little touch. So a string quartet with a overdub of a cello there, perhaps. So once again, mixing in that synthesizer, dynamics start building, but with anything that Michael Brauer does, it's still controlled compression-wise, and that's something that's going to be an overall theme with this whole song, is that you'll notice that every part is controlled. And there's a really good article where Brauer talks about mixing this album in the magazine Sound on Sound, so if you're interested in that, go check it out. But as most mixers know, Michael Brauer uses a multi-bus compression method where he's sending out stems and really controlling the dynamic range of each stem. So like I said, I like the dynamics in the strings in that they build, but they still are controlled, and that's the beauty of it. Also, chord progression-wise, the primary theme, and once again, I would make the argument this song steals from EDM influence, not only orchestral influence, but EDM or dance music influence, because it has a repeating chord progression through almost, I would say, 75 to 80% of the song, which is a 4-chord, a 5-chord, a 1-chord, and a 6-minor chord. So if we're in the key of A flat, that would be like a D flat, E flat, A flat, F minor. And the interesting thing about that chord progression is it starts on the 4-chord. So starts on the 4-chord, so it's always kind of leaving you hanging, if you want to think of it that way. It's never resolving until certain parts of the song, because it does start on the 4-chord. And from the reading I've done, I think that Eno has used that chord progression before, so perhaps that influenced his work with co-writing the song with the band or helping arrange the song. So let's go ahead and listen to the kick drum. So obviously we have a digital kick here. But even listen to the control on that kick. You can just tell, you can hear Michael Brauer in there. Just the control and the way that kick doesn't jump out or jump down, but it still has a nice attack to it. And we should get to a place, if I remember correctly, where a analog, a real kick, is added to that kick. Let's see. There we go. So there comes the real kick, kick drum along with the digital kick. So a nice little addition there on the chorus parts. I'm not sure if the drummer actually plays. Drummer Will, yeah, I don't know if Will plays toms down there, but obviously this speaks to the musicianship of the band, or perhaps the control of the producer, where, you know, the drummer doesn't have to play anything crazy. So yeah, that's just the kick drum. So let's actually go ahead and add the drum stem here and see what's going on there. So sounds like we have some church bells on the offbeat, and I've seen pictures of Will actually playing the church bell and the timpani on this, and they're real church bell, a big real church bell and a timpani. But on the offbeats, once again, that seems to be a theme here, on the offbeats or the ands of the beat. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, and actually that would be every other and for this particular tempo, which is 138 BPM. But you get the idea. And I think it gets a little busier here at the end. Let's look, listen. We've got some bird sound effects once again that were added in, or I don't know if those are birds or seagulls. Another cymbal swell there. Yeah, just a little bit busier there. seagulls or the birds don't change. But now the other interesting thing here, you'll notice that these are the chorus parts, that the bass really is only in, once again, talk about control and minimalism. The bass is only in for the chorus, and or as my friend Sarah Major says, the choral units and the bridge. So let's go ahead and check out the bass tone there. Sounds like we got a picked bass part, maybe even a little amp buzz, but it's rock and roll, right? Most likely a cab and a DI combined, the cab for the low end and the DI for the definition. Nothing crazy, just a nice little picked bass part to give it some definition. Okay, so that pretty much gives us an idea of what the bass is doing. Let's check out the guitars here. Well, obviously that's not guitar, that's keys. Sounds like some piano with what, phaser, a little verb, or a lot of verb. But a shorter verb. And of course, it's not a full band piano. It's very cut. There's our guitar. So you'll notice there's minimal guitar on this, but what guitar you do here, it's more of a mood enhancing type of guitar. So let's check that out. So a little bit of like double stops on the guitar. And then, you know, to me it sounds almost like a reverse reverb on it. But it's definitely, what's interesting is it's definitely not going for clarity. It's more of a texture. So that could be reverse reverb, it could be an ebow being played on the guitar, or all of the above. So there's the bridge. And there's our Eno influence. You can definitely hear U2 in that guitar part with what I call static guitar parts, where the guitar is kind of playing one note, static, or maybe a pedal, if you want to call it that, over the chord changes of the 4-5, 1-6. But you know, he's still changing one note on the top, but the bottom note kind of stays the same. So obviously, you can definitely hear the edge in that part. So it sounds like they're, you know, stereo doubling the guitars, different speakers. But overall, you know, fairly dry on that, in contrast with the piano that has a good amount of medium reverb on it. Let's go down to the strings. We didn't listen on the end, but it's a nice string arrangement. It does build. It still has a synthesizer in there, but let's check it out. So, you know, a cool, interesting thing with this song would be, you know, what would happen if you took out the strings? And my guess would be that they're going to pull most of the weight on this particular song. So let's check that out. That would be interesting theory, right? Totally different song already, right? Let's check out with the vocal now.
I used to roll the dice, feel the fear in my enemy's eyes, listen as the crowd would sing, Now the old king is dead.
It's kind of uninteresting with that. Oh, church bells here to add to the flavor of the song in the background here.
Some reason I can't explain. I know.
Yeah, so obviously those strings do a lot for the song. So that's important for you to know as a producer, if you're an aspiring producer or songwriter, in that, you know, that one element can add so much to the song, and hiring the right person to do that. So David Rossi was a great choice on this for the string arrangement. Okay, let's listen to these additional parts here, see what's going on. Oh, some even vibier guitars, right? So maybe some slide guitar parts, just accenting it. Let's see if we can even hear that in the mix. I'm not sure if I can. I'll go ahead and turn it up, because I always thought that was a string part. And, you know, before I forget, that's another interesting thing about this song from a songwriting perspective. As, you know, there's, what, 8-16 lines of vocal. And then typically, if it was a traditional pop song, it would go right into the next verse. But they actually give it a nice break of, if it's 138, it'd be 8 bars. So it's like, you know, verse, 8-bar instrumental. So they really have to capture your attention there. So they're trying to do some interesting things in this instrumental part, sounds like. Okay, let's see what we got here. Ooh, wow. All right, so are we going a harmonizer or Echoplex or something to create some pretty cool delays there? Echo Boy, perhaps? So that sounds like a string overdub. Wow, we didn't catch that part before on the bridge. That's some... That sounds like a Brian Eno thing to me. It's a harpsichord transcending into the depths of Hades, perhaps. But yeah, just kind of getting freakier and freakier on the harpsichord part. So the interesting thing here on this part would be to listen for clarity, like what instruments are still holding the clarity versus what instruments are descending there. So we got that harpsichord kind of thing. So obviously the thing that's kind of holding it down still is the ostinato there of the strings that are dry. And then we have the freaky guitar number one. Or freaky piano number one with freaky guitar number one with a lot of reverb. And then we have harpsichord, like I said, descending and getting weirder and weirder. Okay, let's talk about the vocal. To me, I can never tell if Chris Martin is sick or, you know, like myself, has, you know, is always stuffed up from allergies. But he definitely has a kind of a nasally warmer sound. It's in the nose on this particular vocal. But I just love the way that Michael Brauer treats these vocals. You can just see from the waveform here that the vocals are definitely controlled dynamically. But they're still intimate enough to sell the song. Of course, the lyrics on this one are, you know, they reference a lot of Bible verses, at least or Christian references. And the lyrics, if you listen for that, I think there's pillars of salt and pillars of sand and St. Peter and head on a plate and all of that, which, you know, it's obviously going back to biblical references. And then the other thing I guess I should mention about the vocal is that there's several folks that sued Coldplay or thought about suing Coldplay for vocal melody plagiarism on this. The one that comes to mind first for me is the Joe Satriani. And, you know, if you're an aspiring songwriter, maybe check that out online. You can actually look up, you know, Coldplay and Viva La Vida and plagiarism and check out the melody, the Joe Satriani song. There's another couple bands, I think, that also claimed it, Creaky Boards and Cat Stevens. from one of his songs from the 70s. But to me, I don't know. I listen to those and I listen to this. It's really, to me, it's not conscious plagiarism, if anything. And then I think the band, when I was reading about this song, the band said that they went back and had a musicologist check it out. And there's even an older Italian composer that all three of those were based on that sued them, which is public domain. So, you know, go figure, it all comes back around. So anyway, the other thing that it's interesting about Brower's technique is that he says, you know, he mixes till each part can hold its own, or each part makes him feel good. And so let's check that out with the vocal. I kind of want to see what his approach was here on this vocal.
I used to rule the world, seas at rise when I gave the word. Now in the morning I sleep alone, sweep the streets I used to own.
So it's a longer verb. So it sounds like he has a longer verb on the vocal than he does on the piano part. But it's still a fairly full-range vocal, very, like I said, very controlled and in your face. With the multiband compression, he can obviously do some parallel compression as well, where he's warming up the vocal, making it sound fat. So it sounds like we got a longer delay, or longer reverb with a little bit of pre-delay there, and then also some delay. So let's just check that out a little bit more. There's probably something else I'm not hearing.
I used to rule the world, seas at rise when I gave the word. Now in the morning I sleep alone, sweep the streets I used to own.
Yeah, the other thing I'm noticing is there's a lot of S's in that particular verse, and none of them are offensive in any way, so he probably has a de-esser on that, I'm guessing.
I used to roll the dice, feel the fear in my enemy's eyes, listen as the crowd would sing. Now the old king is dead, long live the king. 1 minute I held the key, next the walls were closed on me, and I discovered that my castle stand upon pillars of salt and pillars of sand. I hear cherish and a bell.
Okay, so we got a double in there.
Roman cavalry choirs are singing. Be my mirror, my sword and shield. My missionaries in a foreign field. For some reason I can't explain. Once you'd gone, there was never an honest word. And that was when I ruled the world.
So we got a vocal double there on the chorus, which is, you know, a technique that's been used for a long, long time. Primarily they did it in the 50s, 60s, 70s to mask any tuning issues. But I think this has also been auto-tuned, so at least mildly. So I don't think they're masking any vocal issues there. I think they're just making it thicker on the choruses. But what's interesting to me is we have the ability nowadays, production-wise, to perfectly align the transients of the vocals, like with a program called Auto Align or Vocaline. You can do that. And they chose not to, which is, you know, to keep some natural words from not being exactly on from each other. So that's interesting. They still chose to do that as a production decision, which I'm not arguing with. And let's go ahead and listen to the bridge.
Jerusalem bells.
So it sounds like double.
For some reason I...
Yeah, where's the bridge? Come on now. So that, to me, that's about the third hook of the song. First of all, like I said, the ostinato is hook number one. Second one is, I hear Jerusalem bells, that one. And then to me, this is the third kind of sub-hook that the listener is going to walk away singing. So I'm not sure if that's the band or another group of guys singing that, but we've got a choral kind of. So we're going, got an octave lower and then an octave up. And a long verb on that as well. Okay. That motif keeps going under that chorus. And then we finally got the outro, which is almost to me like a Gregorian, or not Gregorian, but I would say like a, you know, 13th, 14th century motet, you know, Josquin, Dupre or something like that, where it's kind of more of an earlier pre-Bach counterpoint kind of thing.
But that was when I ruled the world.
And they choose to fade out on this. So that definitely to me is an Eno thing.
But that was when I ruled the world.
Definitely not the radio mix version, but I think he maybe doubles it with the organ. What's this? Oh, that's nice. Harmonium, perhaps. Wow, that's really nice. Or accordion, I can't tell. But some reed-based instrument. Oh, that's great. I really like that treatment. So that's got to be an Eno thing there. It's pretty cool. All right, so in general, though, you can notice how the vocalist is fairly controlled with the compression scheme that Michael Brauer uses. And like I said, you know, it doesn't jump out when he gets louder or gets softer. It's pretty much dynamically controlled. So that's pretty much it. Go ahead and email me if you have any more questions on Viva La Vida, but I hope you guys enjoyed this particular tutorial.
Welcome back to the Producer's Room. Once again, we're here with L. Russell Brown today, and we were just talking about the song he's probably most known for is Tie a Yellow Ribbon, and I wanted to read some facts off my sheet here. 2008, Billboard magazine ranked the song as the 37th biggest song of all time. It's been cut by 1,300 artists or 1,300 times, I should say. Mm. More, maybe even more.
Countless.
We don't know.
Those are 1,300 we know about it.
Yeah.
Every language in the world, Russian, Chinese, everything.
And when you were talking about we were talking about watching it on YouTube and all the different languages it's in. The song has kind of taken on a life of its own. Perhaps we should address that after we listen to it. But I was reading it was part of the Iran hostage crisis. Is that true?
Yes, it was. It became a welcome home song for the Vietnam veterans. It also became
Hong Kong protests? About that one?
Yeah, and I know that in Corriakino, when she went back to the Philippines, the whole country was covered with yellow ribbons. So,
wow.
So it has taken on a life of its own, but most importantly to me, that it has become a symbol to unite our
right.
country.
Yeah.
A buddy of mine who was a priest once told me he used it, many priests use it in homilies, and many preachers use it in homilies as God welcomes all home.
That's great.
And to my mind, it makes me think of something that Mark Twain once said, David.
Mm-hmm.
Mark Twain once said, home is the only place you can go when there's no place left to go.
Mm.
And I think our song kind of
says beautiful. That. That's beautiful. And so let's go ahead and talk about the background. When you guys came up with the idea and you presented it to Tony, what was the lyrical genesis of this particular song or the... You know, because I know you had told me that you had played your co-writer, Sam Al Jolson, as well, as far as the feel goes on the song. But lyrically and also musically, can you tell me a little bit more about the origins of Tie a Yellow Ribbon?
I used to read and still do read the Reader's Digest every month. And I did the word power contest. That's how I got any vocabulary I do have.
Mm-hmm.
I only went to the eighth grade, which I'm not proud of. But one day I read half a page and it said, here's a story I heard in a Greenwich Village pub that has been handed down through the ages.
Right.
By Pete Hamill. And I said, handed down through the ages, PD. And I hear the story about a guy coming from Andersonville prison. It reads, he's on a stagecoach and he told his girl that he'd been away 3 years and he'd understand if she had someone else, but if she didn't, would she tie a big yellow handkerchief on the big oak tree outside of town. And he told everyone in the stagecoach, including the driver, about this handkerchief. And when they got there, he said, I can't bear to look. And then they said, look. And the whole tree was covered with handkerchiefs. And I got a rush in my neck. I said, boy, that would make a great song.
Yeah.
So I couldn't wait. The next morning, I got in my car. I drove the 33 miles to Levine's house. He had a little above ground pool. And I said to him, Irwin, I got to tell you this story. He said, Brown, please. No more stories. Yeah. I just want to write a song. Tell it fast. So I told it to him. He went, Brown, I just got a rush on my neck. You tell it again, slower. I told him, he said, handkerchiefs have snot in them. That's disgusting. Well, what can we do about it? He said, let's take that and make it a ribbon. I said, I like it, Irwin. He said, and the stagecoach is archaic. Want to make it a bus?
Sure.
I'll buy that. I said, what should we call it, Irwin? Irwin said, let's call it Tie a Yellow Ribbon Around the Old Oak Tree. And I told him I loved it. God rest his soul. Irwin's not with us on this planet. He's watching right now. I know he's listening, so I get it right.
Yes.
And I picked up the guitar, and I sang the opening verse and chorus out of me. Just came right out, like as if I didn't write it, which I probably didn't. And when I finished it, I said, how do you like it, Irwin? Irwin says, I have the second verse. Write this down.
Wow.
So I wrote the words down, and he said, sing the verse, chorus. I did it. He said, do it again and put the tape on. I have the ending. I looked at him. I said, you have the ending in disbelief? He said, trust me, I have the ending. Irwin can write melody and lyric. So when I got to the end of it, verse, chorus, I just hit a G chord, and Irwin sang that great ending. I can't believe I see. And we played it back and jumped up and gave each other a high five, and then played it all over Manhattan for 9 months, and people laughed at us. So we were ridiculous.
So, yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. Did one of you guys take the lyrical reins and one of you took the musical reins, or was it
No, it was like basketball.
Yeah, back and forth.
Back and forth.
Yeah, yeah. And so musically, though, because we were just getting into that before the show, I said to me, this is it's kind of like a whole new genre of combining maybe some older 20s feel kind of instrumentation, but still with a new take on it. So can you tell me how you guys arrived at the feel musically for the song?
I didn't try to do anything. I just picked up the guitar.
Yeah.
And it just played what it wanted to.
Right, right.
So I'm fairly positive that we really don't deserve as much credit for writing that song, because that song was written in 12 minutes.
Right.
And you've heard about these stories like this.
Well, that's what I was going to even ask you is, have you noticed this trend with all your other hits? Do they come fast? Or does it just vary?
I never looked for the greatest songs I've ever written. I never looked for.
Yeah.
I waited for them.
Huh.
As opposed to search for them.
Right.
And if I waited long enough, they came out.
Great.
That's
good to hear.
And every time I ever bought a guitar, I always looked in it and smelt it. I had to make sure they were in there because I had very little to do with it. And I had to make sure, like I just had to get them out of there.
Mm-hmm.
And Sweet Gypsy Rose just came out. Actually, that was written in the back of a car at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Well, there's a good quote by Quincy Jones. He says that we are all just a conduit that God flows through. And
he's 100%.
Yeah.
I never met Quincy Jones, but wherever you are, Quincy, I am with you 1,000,000%.
Yeah, and that's kind of what it sounds like there. But you played the chords and you wrote the lyrics down, so, you know. So you played it for Tony. Well, let's just play it. Start talking about it, and feel free once again to talk over the record as it plays and tell me about production or lyrics.
First person I wanted to play it for was Ringo Starr.
Wow.
And because we had so many hits before that, both of us, I was able to get up to Apple Records and meet the director. I'm not going to say his name.
Sure.
I think I shouldn't have done that in the past, but I have. And we played it for him, and when I got to the chorus, he grabbed the guitar and he deadened the strings with his hand and said, how dare you come and play me garbage like this when we have Pink Floyd and the Beatles? This is ridiculous about a ribbon in the tree. Do you have anything good to play today?
Oh, my gosh.
So Irwin looked at me, and I looked at him like Heckle and Jekyll, those two birds.
Yeah.
And we said, this is all we have today. We went to the elevator, and it was one of those elevators that had those little thing that went like that that told you what floor it was on. Big piece of metal, and we said some choice words about this guy. And we kept on playing this song because we believed in it. We never made a demo on it. And finally, in total frustration, we said, let's play it for Hank and see what he thinks about it. The man who produced Knock Three Times.
Yeah.
Hank heard it one time. He sat there stoically, never said a word. When it was all done, he jumped up and went, smash, I'm cutting with Tony.
Awesome.
And that's...
Wow. But see, you know, I could hear Ringo singing this. So tell me about some of the lyrics, because I was looking here. You of course mentioned the last verse, and that's really what gets people.
But how did it go from being about a prisoner to the war? Is that just a life it took on?
It really wasn't about a criminal. It was about a man who was a prisoner of war in the Civil War.
Yeah. Okay.
Andersonville Prison.
The original, yeah.
But it's been misinterpreted by many people to think that this man came home from a prison.
I got you.
As committing a crime,
yeah.
Which he didn't. So it really is a war song. Now, when Irwin wrote the end of that, it just blew my mind on the spot.
Yeah.
And as it touched a lot of people, millions of people, I've always went with my stomach when it came to a song. If I heard a song like You Were the Wind Beneath My Wings and It Put the Rush on My Neck, which I think is one of the greatest songs that's ever come out of Nashville. Nashville's been good to me. Right up the street, when I first moved back here. I was away for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
I met a man named Mike Dodd from Dodd Dreaming right up the street. Mm-hmm. He was an accountant who helped put my life together. He's an incredible guy, an honest guy, a great guy. And I found there's great people in this town, especially for music people.
Yeah, and this is your G chord here.
And I can't believe I see. You know, this song has a lot of changes. And the following year, one of my favorite songs was written by one of my favorite writers.
Uh-huh.
Had this exact odd chord progression.
Really?
Yes, and it's a different kind of song, but I love this song. And it's called How Deep Is Your Love?
Oh, the Bee Gees.
Barry Gibb wrote the same exact chord progression. So this is a very odd chord progression. It's got 15 chords in it.
Well, speaking of similarities, I read somewhere where your Four Seasons song was perhaps inspiration for The Doors, or is that another topic?
The following year, they had the same words and the same riff. Come on, come on, come on, touch me, babe. But as I told you, I was a huge fan.
So
I just let it go because I just love The Doors.
Yeah. Well, Tie a Yellow Ribbon, I mean, there's so much we could keep going on that. But I want to hear what you've been up to nowadays. So first of all, we talked about the Four Seasons hit being in The Jersey Boys, which has done fabulous on Broadway. I mean, how many weeks was it? Was it on Broadway? Is it still on Broadway?
It's still on Broadway.
Oh, my gosh.
Not only is it on Broadway, it's on Broadway. It's got a touring company. It's in Las Vegas. It's been in Las Vegas for four or five years. It's in the Netherlands. It's in the West End in London. And I think, and they're about to put one in Sweden, I think.
Wow.
So it's constantly being played.
Yeah.
And people are, and Bob Gaudio, my dear buddy, tells me that it's going to be all over the world before it's over.
That's great. And then the movie, too. Was it last year it came out, or Clint Eastwood?
The movie came out last summer.
Yeah, awesome. Let's talk about The Sunset Game, because
let's finish with the Come On, Marianne for one other thing.
Go ahead.
You know, in the movie, Bob Gaudio called me over to the studio when he was doing a soundtrack for the movie. He said, Larry, Clint Eastwood, the producer, omitted your song, Come On, Marianne, from the movie. And I was really hurt by that.
Yeah.
And then he called me over 2 months later and said, Larry, thank God for you that Clint Eastwood omitted your song, because George Lucas included it in his $100 million movie Primrose, coming out next year. Now we can go forward.
No. But that's what I was going to ask you. Is how did you get your interest in writing for Broadway and writing for musical theater? I mean, had you always had interest in that, or does that something develop?
I love the theater.
Okay,
I love Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Yeah,
George Gershwin, Cole Porter.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that one of the problems with today's writers is my heroes were Hank Williams, George Gershwin, Cole Porter. I don't know who the kids are listening to today.
Yeah.
And man, these people were 40 years before my time.
Sure.
Still, I was affected by their Irving Berlin, the great songs.
Right.
So I don't know who the people are listening to today.
Yeah.
But I love those people. So
tell me about how this, did this idea come to you?
Donna Reed had a foundation, her husband created a foundation for the great actress.
Okay.
And I went out to Denison, Iowa. I was asked to give a course in songwriting.
Okay.
And I met this man right here. Warren Adler.
I'll go ahead and show it for the camera so we can get a little picture there. Sunset Gang. Cool.
We were in a town that rolled up the windows at 5 o'clock.
Yeah.
And we were in the parking lot talking, and he told me some stories of a trilogy he had on PBS, which won a big Golden Globe. And one of them, I called him back early in the morning, and 2 in the morning I said, I can't sleep. This one story you told me about this people who are retirement village, a love story.
Yeah.
I said, why don't we make a show out of it? He said, write a couple of songs. And that's how it began.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we worked this thing. We had it off Broadway, but we finally got it in the condition where it's really ready to be put up.
And so, but you said it was off Broadway for a while, and now you've revamped it a little bit. And
no, we've completely redone it.
Okay.
And we found a lot of flaws in it. We fixed them.
Good.
And we think we made a great show. I presented it to the Senior Theater Operators of America in June in Bally's Theater in Atlantic City, and there was a couple hundred people there, and I was astounded because some people cried.
Oh. That's...
And when I seen that, I like almost couldn't continue to sing. So Larry Wuchholz, the dean over at Belmont, loves this play. He would like the theater department to put this play on at Belmont. That would be a great place.
We should. So tell me about Warren, your co-writer, book and lyrics. So he was the original idea, like you said, and does he have a background too as a screenwriter or book writer?
Warren wrote The War of the Roses.
Oh, okay.
He also wrote the movie with, you know, the guy who was just hurt, Harrison Ford?
Yes.
It was a movie
that... I hope he's all right.
Yeah, he's going to be all right.
Yeah.
There's a movie where they were in a plane crash,
and
they each had a key. He wrote that book too.
Oh, wow.
He wrote several movies, but his biggest one is the War of the Roses, which is a legitimate show now on Broadway.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. It turned into a musical,
too. And this is a fabulous story about...
Tell me about the story, because I want to hear a little bit more about it. Or can you divulge that?
I can quickly give you a synopsis. What it is it's two couples.
Right.
They retire to a famous retirement village in South Florida. In the one house, the man is very content to be there. He has his poker friends and gin friends.
Yeah.
And the woman, she hates it. She wants to see the world. She still wants to be young and vibrant. But he's kind of like had it. He just wants to relax. And then the other house, there's a man who still wants to see the world and still wants to dance and make love and be young. But the woman, she's kind of had it. She has her little clutch of canasta players and whatever. Mm-hmm. And these people are destined to meet. Their mates tell them, if you're so bored, why don't you join a club? Mm-hmm. So they join a social club. And these are people married in 45 years. And these two people meet. And the inevitable happens. Even though they're married that long, they fall deeply in love.
Right.
Everyone in this little village talks. You know, they got a little talk. And it's a... And at the end of the first act, she says, she realizes when he tells her he's in love with her, she runs away to Boston. She says, I can't deal with this. I've been married 47 years, and she's a moral woman. After being away for a week or so, she comes back. His heart is breaking. And she sees him, and he says to her, I'll never come on to you again. Just don't ever leave. And she says, you don't get it, Bill. I'm here for you. Life is short. And they sing a song called From September to December. And it's a beautiful love story. In the end, there's a tremendous argument between the families of the clubhouse.
Mm-hmm.
Madness breaks out. But in the end, they leave together. And they go off and they spend those last golden years together.
Yeah.
Maybe I was ahead of my time 30 years ago, but today...
And the segue is the other two spouses get together?
That'd be nice. They don't need anybody. They're really quite sufficient, self-sufficient. This is a love story you know, between senior people who can still fall in love.
I think that's great. It's so relevant, you know.
And the songs are kind of like they're kind of like Guys and Dolls. They have that kind of flavor.
But it sounds like so much fodder for you to work with as a songwriter. I mean, a lot of different stories, either the main characters or the people at the retirement community.
Oh, it was incredible fun.
Yeah.
I can't, just to watch the people read the book and perform the songs is such a thrill. It's such a high. There's no greater high than the number one record. That's still the greatest thing in the world. But there is a special feeling to sit down and watch people act out your music
on stage. Yeah.
And that's where I am right now.
So hopefully that happens, you know, and the next year. And then tell me about your book. We were discussing that briefly before we got started. And you're writing a book on your life story.
I went back to New Jersey for a year and a half. And while I was there, I went back for one mission. And the mission was to write my life story. And I chose another songwriter to sit at the computer in front of me and write it. This is a great songwriter who wrote songs like I'm Working My Way Back to You, Let's Hang On, A Lover's Concerto. He got the Grammy for writing and producing Dr. Buzzard, Savannah Band. He dropped you off on East 83rd. Yeah. You're a native New Yorker.
Yeah.
He's written 20 number one songs.
Can we say his name?
His name is Sandy Linzer. And Sandy and I wrote a few number one songs together.
Wow.
Dance records, number one pop records all over the world called Use It Up, Wear It Out. And we've had great success, but I love Sandy's writing, and we wrote a book together. Two songwriters wrote My Life Story, and it's called I'm L. Russell Brown, I Wrote Tie a Yellow Ribbon Round the Old Oak Tree, and This Is My Story.
I like that.
Of course, I give Irwin all his due. Irwin Levine,
yes.
In the book.
Yes.
But that's the title of the book for now.
That's great. And so you were talking about Nashville, and I just wanted to ask you, how would you compare the community, the musical community here to what you came up with on the East Coast? And, I mean, you enjoy the creative community here in Nashville?
I think the community here is constantly changing.
Okay.
It's not what it was 20 years ago. It's a different kind of thing, and it has a lot to do with the preservation of record companies and the industry. And because of all the illegal downloading, the record companies had to have more than just the record sales.
Yeah.
They had to own the acts for public performances and all those kind of things. And that's how the industry has changed.
So, so if you were giving advice to an aspiring songwriter or musician, artist, would you have any advice in today's climate, today's music business?
My advice would be the same advice I gave Johnny Bon Jovi when he was sweeping up the power station for his cousin, who owned the power station, Tony Bon Jovi. And that he asked me, how do you get into the business, Brown? I seen Johnny at the Morton's around a month ago.
Oh, really?
He was in town. And we hugged and we talked about this when he was 17. I hadn't seen him since then. And I told him, the main thing, if you really want to be a success in this industry or any other industry,
yeah,
the main thing is to be great at rejection. If you become a master at rejection,
yes,
you become one of the greatest people that ever was at rejection, you're going to be a winner.
Wow, I like
that's
that.
That's the
I
main
like that.
Advice.
Because it takes us back to your Yellow Ribbon story, you know, and just persistence to get the song
persistence cut. Until there's those yellow ribbons are waiting for you.
Amen to that. All right. So I was telling you about this segment that we have. It's called Five on the Fly. And we just surprise guests, you know, with
don't beat
random
me up
questions.
Now.
Speaking of beating up, though, our first question, have you ever been in a fist fight?
My most famous fist fight, my father and this boy's father were playing softball, and we got into it. And he must have hit me 20 times for every time I hit him, but I never went down, just like a Raging Bull.
There you go.
And when it was all over, he gave me a hug and said, Brown, you're tough.
Wow.
He went on to, he just got out after doing 25 years. He was the Don of the, he went on to become the Don of the Lucchese crime family.
Oh.
He did, and he just got out after admitting to 15 whacks. He got 25 to life, and he got out
and we can say that
ago.
On TV, right?
Can we say that on TV? I'm not going to say his name, but
we got it.
But it's a difficult thing, but that's the kind of people I grew up with. Either they became police officers, like my dearest buddies,
right.
Or they went the other way.
And then there was one songwriter, right? And that was you.
I'm the only one I know that came out of there.
All right, so speaking of John Bon Jovi and Morton's, how do you like your steak cooked?
I like my steak cooked, barely cooked.
All right.
Medium.
And you never gotten any foodborne illness from that, or...?
I've gotten foodborne.
Take a chance.
My desire for food, as you can see, overcomes my fear of poison food.
Okay, that's good. That's good. All right, so let's see what else we got. Do you own any inflatable furniture?
Yes, as a matter of fact, down in my cave room, I told my wife I'm taking that blow-up bed out where I write out, and I'm going to put it upstairs and put another chair in there. I have a blow-up bed because I have 7 grandchildren. Sometimes you have to have a place.
Yeah, you do. You do have to have a place. So the last two questions I have for you are music-related, and when I look back on all your works, you're such a great story. You tell a great story in your songs, a great story songwriter, and I was going to ask you, what is your favorite story song besides ones that you've written?
I walked up to John Hartford in the Palace Theater, and I said to him, if I could have written any other song besides Tie a Yellow Ribbon, it would have been in your song, Gentle on My Mind. First time I heard it, I knew it was pure magic. I would
cut
say
by Glenn Campbell.
Glenn Campbell, but probably, so many other people. Yeah. I also like the September song.
Oh, that's a beautiful. Who is that?
I love the version by Jimmy Durante.
Yeah,
Jimmy Durante. And I love what it has to say. It was written by the man, Kurt Weill, who wrote Mac the Knife.
Didn't know that.
Kurt Weill wrote Mac the Knife, which is from a German play called Dry Madel House, Three Penny Opera.
Wow.
You know, so I love
I can
Kurt
think
Weill.
Of Willie's version of that song and Jeff Lynne's version of it.
Oh, Willie
yeah,
killed it.
Yeah. And Stardust.
I love what that song has to say. I also love Larry Henley's song, You Were the Wind Beneath My Wings.
Yes.
My writing partner, Roger Cook's song, You Got Your Troubles, I Got Mine, I Like to Teach the World to Sing.
Yeah.
You know, I've been blessed to write with people, especially my mentor, Bob Crewe.
Oh, yeah.
Who found me, discovered me, and taught me how to write songs the right way.
Wow.
He wrote Can't Take My Eyes Off You, produced all the Four Seasons records, wrote Lady Marmalade, Silhouettes on the Shelf.
Wow.
I mean, Bob Crewe died 5 months ago. God rest his soul. He was a friend and a teacher and a proctor, a person who...
It's great to have those mentors.
I was blessed to have Bob Crewe.
So last question. I just want to know about an experience or a favorite artist that you worked with over your career, if you had to pick out one artist. Now, I know you were a producer as well, and I wish we would have had some more time to get into that with Billy and the Beaters, and you won a Juno Award with the, what was the Blue
Good Brothers?
Good Brothers. And but as far as just either writing for other artists or working with them in the studio, you have any favorites?
Before I ever wrote a hit, Frankie Valli used to stick his head in the little room, the writing room, and say, Brown, write me a hit. That's before I ever wrote a hit, and he had 15 hits.
Wow.
So working with Frankie and having a hit with him was a great thrill because he filled me up with the thought that I could write a hit before
sure.
I wrote one.
Sure.
And he was that kind of guy, and he's still performing today with the vibrance of a 20-year-old. And Tony, working with Tony, being on the stage with Tony and being with Tony, he's so gracious, and he's done so many hits for me that, I'm a blessed person to have worked with these brilliant giants.
Yeah. That wraps up this episode of The Producer's Room with Dave Tough. I want to thank everybody for watching, and we'll see you next time. So we were talking earlier, you met John Belushi on an airplane?
He was on the other side of the aisle, and he was dribbling against the window in a lumberjack jacket. And we got up to have a cigarette. I walked up to him, and I told him, John, yada, yada. I wrote Yellow Ribbon. I'm L. Russell Brown, yada, yada. And he went, I never heard of No Tie Yellow Ribbon. And he hit me in the arm. He said, Stuart, it's come over here. And he looked at me, and he said, didn't you ever see The Best of Belushi where I do Beethoven? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And he took me to his hotel. We became friends. We watched the Cincinnati game together there.
Really?
Yes, it was amazing.
All
and the tragedy was, 6 weeks later, he died in that room.
Ooh.
He told me on the airplane someone was trying to kill him. And I told him, no one's trying to kill you. I was wrong. Somebody was trying to kill him. It was him.
Hmm. Wow,
but,
that's deep.
I know it's a dark thing to say, but I loved John Belushi. I felt I knew him all my life. And I treated him, I was kind of abusive to him. I pushed him around a lot and said some nasty
words.
You
got out your samurai sword?
Yes. What do you know about Hanukkah?
There's like, what, seven candles? Or, you know, I was really hoping after we did this interview that, you know, you and I could like write a song together or something. What are you doing after the show?
That's a sensational idea. But see, I sprained my hand real bad and I can hardly move it. When the fingers come back into shape again and I can move them again, we'll definitely sit down and we'll do something.
Well, thank you.
It's a pressure.
There we go. That was good.